Hi, I'm Neal Romano. Welcome to Outdoor Wild.
Hi guys, I'm Tierza, and today we are lucky enough to visit with some scientists from the wetland area so we can find out just how important the wetlands are. Follow us, stay tuned.
Okay, we're standing here with George at Northwestern University in Illinois. And George, you're going to educate us a little bit about what's going on in this place.
Absolutely. What we're trying to do here is to look at the capacity of the river and the restored wetlands here and the ripple structure itself to remove pollutants from the water. Now, these pollutants may be present in very small quantities and very small amounts, but we believe that there is an ecosystem, a microbial ecosystem, so bacteria that are capable of removing these pollutants.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
So we took some water samples. We're going to be measuring what chemicals are present in this water and how that changes across the river and across the ripple structure.
Okay, so you find what you think may be possible answers. Mm-hmm. These get submitted further beyond so people can come and do some clean up this river, if possible, or what?
Well, that's actually, these chemicals, these pollutants I'm talking about are ubiquitous. These are chemicals that you find in essentially any water body that's even semi-impacted by human activity.
Okay.
It's anywhere near human, so it's not specific to this river. What we're trying to show is that the types of systems, this restored riparian zone and wetlands, are beneficial for multiple reasons. They select for wildlife habitat, but they also have services that they provide in terms of pollutant removal. And so there's another reason to either restore wetlands or to save the wetlands that we already have.
Very good.
Okay, that's what happens in a wetland. It gets very clear, and the wetlands take out a lot of the nutrients. And of course, we have cleared this of carp. Carp is the number one contaminator of our streams, the common carp, the one that was introduced in about the 1880s.
Donna wanted to point out how clear the water is because all of the vegetation in the marsh, the indigenous vegetation, filter out all the bad stuff. That's why, one of the many reasons why marshes are so important.
And keeping the carp out.
That's right.
And they keep the carp out. Because we're too good for carp.
Now you could hear a bullfrog back in there, I would guess.
I did hear him.
But it's, setches are very good, and we have one species that people from the University of Wisconsin have been studying. It's the tussock sedge. And the tussock sedge creates kind of a clump, and it's very good at taking carbon out of the atmosphere and storing it in the soil. And so we're thinking of doing some major, in our next project, restoration just in tussock sedge, or another sedge, which is aquabulus. What we want to do is we want to plant this sedge like this, and most people want to burn these fields off. It was an Indian, I think more of a part of their warring, that they burn prairies and hunting because they would clear a field so they could see the deer a long way. So they would set fire to the plants, and some plants adapted to that and did very well under a fire regime. So people want to burn it. But the problem is, you put the carbon right back up in the atmosphere.
Right.
So what we want to experiment with this, because we'll be doing it with wastewater treatment plants, we want to be able to harvest this, mow it, rake it up, and then take it and put it in their digesters. Now their digesters take the solids, from the wastewater treatment plant and consolidate it. And so we would put this in.
To help get the gases from going up to absorbing them and pulling them down.
Well, what we do is though we would create methane and we put that into the pipeline. We'd sell that to Getty Oil or, you know, some pipeline system. And so instead of frying your egg on methane that came out of a well someplace,
right, it's
or
from
fracking, that it would come from the vegetation that helped take the carbon out of the atmosphere and provided wildlife habitat, flood control, and all these other benefits.
Is it proven to work? Is this proven to work?
We don't know.
We're gonna see.
We don't know yet. We don't know what the economics. We know sedges grow under conditions like this. They don't like deep water. They're more shallow water. And we know that they like it, they've done well, and we know that it takes a lot of carbon out of the atmosphere. So we want to see if we just can't take that carbon and shift directions and use it. Because we're constantly looking for ways of using wetlands to generate income. Because we believe to have even a fraction of part of our wetlands return. And we've lost 100 million acres of wetlands. Just to return part of that, there's going to have to be a major incentive.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what the greatest incentive is for Americans?
Yeah.
Money.
Yep.
Put money in their hands, they'll do it. But what we want to do is we want to experiment with that. And we're looking at ways of earning money
from
levies. And we figure on an acre per acre basis, a farmer could increase his income by a factor of 4 or 5.
And not damage the land.
And not
at
damage
all.
The land.
And
no.
Not even do anything. Not there's no upkeep except for the burn at the end.
Well, yeah. And then if you don't burn, if you mow, then the plants are all there and you take your clippings, if you will, down to the local treatment plant.
Right.
They put it in their digester and there we go.
Brilliant.
Mercury is raining down on us right now.
Yes.
And we have mercury in the fish out here that are very close to the standards for food safety.
In our lake?
In this
river. I thought it was just tuna and... No, they're in fresh lakes.
And it's getting, of course, out to Lake Michigan because the winds are prevailing southwest and all of the coal-burning fire plants line the river southwest.
Right.
So it blows the mercury up. Now, there was a professor at University of Illinois in Chicago who was studying this. Unfortunately, he died, but he was quite an expert on the distribution of mercury dispersal from these plants out to the lake. And that's why eating salmon and the fish out of the lake is risky.
How scary, I didn't know that.
Yeah, no, and they say, as far as I know, we're not doing anything about it. It's not
no.
an issue. It's like pharmaceuticals in the water. You know, people kind of know it's a problem, but they're not doing anything about the pharmaceuticals.
No, they're not.
I think it goes with the theory of out of sight, out of mind, which there's a lot of in our world today.
Yeah.
People don't really stop to analyze.
Or ignorance is bliss, you know.
As long as we don't know about it, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Fish is the usually the largest provider of mercury.
Right, and all the vegetarians that are only eating fish is their protein substitute.
And I have a friend who got mercury poisoning because of that.
Yeah.
No kidding.
It's really all I eat.
And she has stopped. Yeah, she stopped eating, you know, the sushi, the raw fish.
Yeah.
And, well, even if you cook it, you get rid of the mercury.
Right.
So mercury is a major problem.
So the mercury from the factories, it floats over, it gets in the water.
Yeah, mostly from power generators.
From power generators.
Yes, power generators. Burning coal.
The burning of coal brings it over, and it lands in the water, and the fish are eating it. What about mammals?
Yeah, well, mammals that are eating vegetation get the same thing.
So cows?
The cows eating the grass would get the same thing.
And we're just not looking for mercury.
We're just not, that's right, we're not looking.
So even plants are if that theory is true, even plants are off.
Sure.
They're absorbing.
What am I supposed to
eat? They're absorbing. Well, that's it. And that's one of the reasons why I'm interested in trying the harvesting of the plants and then digesting it. Because the plants suck up a lot of the mercury, other heavy metals, and if you put it in a digester, then they go to the bottom with all the other stuff, and you take that out to a hazardous waste dump, so it doesn't ever enter the center system again. But the gas doesn't carry off the mercury.
Gotcha.
Now, that's hypothesis. We really need to have it proven, and maybe you've read someplace.
For the gas.
Yeah, for the gases.
Gas can be scrubbed, the biogas, if you turn the plant matter into methane, for example. That can be scrubbed, so that can be cleaned.
So we'd solve two huge problems.
Absolutely, yeah. Good solution.
And we've only walked maybe a mile?
Yeah.
Have we walked a mile?
Solving the world's problems off the highway in Chicago.
This is, or was, a turtle nest.
Oh, I see eggs in there.
Are they still all together?
If I put my hand in, am I going to get bitten?
I don't think so.
No, they're opened.
Okay, turtle body. So the eggs are open, Tierza?
Yeah.
They've either hatched out or a predator's come along and eaten them.
How do we know?
Jerry?
You can usually see if it's all dug up there, but it's kind of hard. No, those would be hatched because otherwise they're all smashed up.
Oh, okay.
Can you tell what kind of turtle it is from its egg? Jerry.
She's probably a snapper, I guess.
Mark him down just because he...
Jerry, you're done.
You gotta taste it and I'll find out.
Jerry, you taste it first.
Jerry, it looks like two of us are hitting the road today.
Yeah, I know.
Is he indigenous?
No. We're going to let the little guy go. I almost stepped on him, and I thought I'm going to turn him toward this creek here.
Also an indigenous?
I think that's indigenous as well. But you see, it's an early bloomer. It's aggressive. It moves into open space.
Will this one bloom too, or is this it?
That's the bloom.
That's
the snake master.
This is also the seed?
Yep. Once it dries up, you'll be able to pluck it off, and there'll be little rigid seeds in there.
Now, Jerry, is the Queen Anne's lace indigenous?
No.
It is not?
No, it is not.
Oh, okay.
It's edible, though.
The flower is edible?
No, the
stem?
Root.
You eat it first, Jerry. You eat it first.
It's carrots.
Just you eat it first.
Well,
I've heard of this.
We'll try it.
Do it. I heard that the Amish do a lot of preparing of these type of plants. Was the Amish that raised them? I've heard of this.
Probably won't. It's not so far along.
But yeah, you can smell it. Can you smell it? It's a carrot.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Does it taste like a carrot?
Mm-hmm. My daughter eats them.
Show me.
Well, it's raw.
Is that like a carrot?
You're tight.
I suppose she wanted me to
taste
it.
Is it a carrot or not? Let me taste it. I just have to make sure, Jerry.
I think you should get further down.
I don't have a lot of trust for men. Gotta make sure.
I wouldn't either.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I think I'll try it as long as Tears is doing it.
Yeah.
She's still standing.
Let's go down. Let's go down together. If we're going down, you guys, we're a team.
See, I don't know. Probably better off breaking. See, these shoots are usually better.
The shoots are better? So this part of the root is better than this guy.
Yeah, usually bigger than this. Because it's...
But you're not recommending people to come out to the wetlands and pick these.
Don't steal them from our property.
Usually to manage them, we just cut...
They actually are like
we just cut it. So the seeds don't, heads don't go to seed, so that way they don't reproduce next year.
It actually is good, other than
the
dirt mite.
But if it's bloomed already, wouldn't the, so where's the seed coming from then?
This would mature into dry seed, but it's wet, so.
So as it's a flower, you can cut it.
As it's a flower, you cut it, it won't be viable.
What's the name of this?
Butterfly weed.
Butterfly weed.
It's a milkweed.
There you go.
How are they for monarchs? I know monarchs are more, that's a great, okay.
Yeah, they were sitting by the parking lot this morning.
Okay, because monarchs also do the milk
regular
weed,
milk
pod, and am I endangered?
And that's the regular milkweed's not native, but it's the host for the monarch, so we don't kill it or anything.
Right.
In fact, a lot of agencies are proposing that you should plant it just for the monarchs, and they're overlooking the non-native part of it, which is pretty cool.
So milkweed?
Yep.
And the monarch's endangered, not the milkweed.
Right, the monarch. Okay. Well, actually, the milk pod, there's less milk pod weeds now, and that's they actually urge people
part
of the farmer. It's kind of like with the bee problem. They're not quite sure they're looking at the pesticides, but they are urging people to plant in their yards. Mm-hmm. Milk pods attract monarchs.
Got it.
Des Plaines River was contained by the riffle structure.
Okay.
And it had to rise up in order to go over the riffle structure. And by increasing the water depth, it blocked the movement of groundwater into the river. And so the roots of these trees were then flooded. And these are species that can't tolerate flood water very well, and so they died. And most of our floodplains in Illinois, pre-settlement, were free of trees. There virtually were no trees. There were a lot of grasses, reeds, other vegetation such as that, that populated the floodplain, not trees. Down at the most southern part of Illinois is the northernmost stand of the buttress tree that grows in the bayous and swamps along the Gulf of Mexico. But they couldn't take the cold weather, and so they didn't move any further north. These trees were probably ash or some other such species. And when they are flooded, they die. And we intended for that to happen, so that the marsh could survive, the marsh grasses could prosper.
Very good. Now the ash trees also, just so folks know, now these weren't all ash trees, there was different trees in here.
They're other species, that's
yes.
Correct.
Yes, they are, you know about the MRR and ash borer beetle, yeah, that's taking over the ash trees too. That's a pretty severe problem at times of day, so every now and then we throw something like that in the show so people are up to date with what's going on.
Well, these did not die from the...
No, these are from the flood. From the water rising.
Right.
Right.
From the water rising. And we have cottonwoods and a few other big trees back there that died the same way. And you'll see it all along the Des Plaines River as you move north, where the water level has increased a little bit.
Right.
And again, the trees closest to the river and subject to higher groundwater levels,
right,
will be in the process of dying.
Very interesting. Well, you know, Donald, it educates folks that may be tuning in that don't know the reason for this. A lot of people don't know that. You drive by, you see the dead trees, but really, all those trees dead. There's your answer.
Yep, there it is.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can you explain to me what you're going to do, what you're testing for, and how it's going to happen?
Absolutely. So we're taking some water samples and some sediment samples. What we're interested in is looking at both nutrients. We're interested in looking at services provided by the riparian zone and the wetland here, in particular pollutant removal services. So we're interested in looking at removal of nutrients and also removal of pharmaceuticals and personal care products that could be present in very small concentrations in the river.
Let me see if I understood. So you're going to see if this river is providing its own source of a way to remove chemicals.
That's exactly
and
right.
And we're going to find out what in the river can do that and how much of it can do.
That's exactly right. Yep.
Okay, and can you show me how that happens?
Absolutely, we can do that.
Where's your accent from?
Minnesota.
Do you don't fool with me, George.
Do you hear a Canadian accent?
I heard some, yeah.
I get Canada all the time. I love Canada, but it's Minnesota.
Doctor.
All right. Why don't you do this, Chew? Do you want to take a water sample here?
This is Chew, by the way. Dr. Chew, for those of you at home.
Not yet.
Dr. Raj. Not yet, but hopeful.
Not yet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this is the syringe, it's sterilized. And this is the filter. We take 6 mL water from the river and push the water through the filter. So the water can go through, but not the biofuel. In that case, we can get microbes in the water. and later on we will analyze this in the lab.
Amazing. So this part's going to come back with you, and you're going to open that up and explore what's inside.
Right. There's a filter paper inside. So we open, cut this open and take the filter paper out. And we extract the microbe and the DNA of the microbe from the filter paper. In that case, we can get the DNA sequence and analyze this, what's the microbe community it is.
Chu, are you on board with this from beginning to end, or do you come out here and then hand this off to somebody?
I will operate it myself.
You're going to do it yourself? So this is your this is the fantastic life you've chosen.
Yeah.
You get to hike in fields, take some water, and then hang out in an air-conditioned lab.
Right.
Is there TV on in the background?
Hope so.
What's your favorite show to watch?
Discovery.
Perfect. Raj, what's your job?
So I'm going to take this bottle. It's a 1 liter bottle, and we're just going to take it into the river, put it upside down, and then turn it right side up so that the water can fill in. And the reason that it's amber is so that we want to prevent any degradation of the chemicals so that we can prepare it as necessary and send it out to a colleague of George's, and so he can analyze what chemicals are in here.
And the reason why you put it underwater like this and then turn it, and the reason is you don't want the film on the top?
Right. We want to see what's kind of underneath that surface.
Interesting.
Tell her what chemicals you're looking for.
So,
snuck up on me.
So as George mentioned, we're looking for pharmaceuticals and personal care products. So they're the sorts of chemicals that you would find in household objects. So for example, antibacterial soap has an antibacterial agent called triclosan, and that's what we're hoping to find. Also, these chemicals can exist in shampoos or toothpaste. In addition, we'll be looking for pesticides and herbicides that are coming from farms up north.
That are going to benefit us in the end. So to keep the chemical in the pesticides and the soap, because in the end it'll benefit us instead of being hazardous. Right? Did I confuse things?
Well, so there's small amounts of these chemicals that get into waterways, and we're looking for sustainable, natural ways of removing them, of limiting negative influence of these chemicals.
Mm-hmm.